People are terrible. Aww. They kill, steal, humiliate, and degrade one another. But the worst thing human beings ever did was start pretending like a hilarious t-shirt was a replacement for a personality.
I have always dressed like this.
The term hipster started out in the 40s, then slowly evolved over the past 70 years as part of a long tradition of post-World War II counterculture movements. Various strains have existed at various times, but the theme has been consistent. Rich white kids acting like they're not rich or white. The term hipster has its roots in the 1940s, when the word hep was popularized on the jazz scene.
I have hep R. You probably haven't heard of it.
The origin of the word seems to be from a slang term for opium, or possibly from an African word for having your eyes opened. The first recorded use of hipster was in the liner notes to a 1944 album. It was defined as characters who like hot jazz.
Have you ever heard cold rap or like lukewarm reggae?
By the 1950s, hipsters had started giving way to the beatnik movement. They wore black. They smoked European cigarettes. They were less directly influenced by black culture, but they still used the word hep to mean culturally sophisticated. In the early 60s, the word hip was back, but in a new form, hippies. It was used to describe the earthy, anti-capitalist, marijuana-fueled culture of Greenwich Village in San Francisco. Zoot suits were gone, but hip remained, and it had listened to a lot of Joan Baez.
Can I have another PBR?
In the late 1970s, a new subculture of hipness was born in Harlem, hip-hop, which centered around rap, dancing, and graffiti. Black people finally got their word back. In the white community, younger people were stretching to find a counterculture movement that wasn't part of the boomer-controlled dialectic of hippiedom. Hey, a lot of them took to British punk culture as an inspiration. In the 1980s, punk and hip-hop continued to grow, but the signature sentiment of the 80s was a rebellion against the 60s and 70s by embracing capitalism and conservatism. It was a decade when the counterculture was the mainstream culture, and no one was hip. It made for terrible fashions, but very good sitcoms. By the 90s, hip-hop had gone mainstream and the hippies were in their 40s. Hipness was no longer hip. It was Paula Abdul.
I started the 90s.
So people started showing their cultural sophistication ironically by emphasizing how unsophisticated they were, how unwashed, how unhipped, how grungy.
Disgusting.
To the adherents of 90s grunge, refusing to wash your hair or properly tune your guitar were the clear signs you were one of the cool kids. The end of the 90s saw a strong comeback in mainstream culture. The Spice Girls, boy bands, teen comedies, and Dave Matthews all celebrated the relative peace and prosperity of the post-Cold War era. And the re-marginalized anti-corporate music scene started to evolve into the hipster community we know today. In the late 1990s, we were searching for a word that indicated cultural sophistication, but was separated from the creepiness of hippiness or the mainstream popularity of hip-hop. Hipster,
I am not a hipster.
A relic of the 1940s, was clearly separated from hip-hop and hippies, and was nostalgically charming. It was the steampunk of words.
Zeppelin.
In 2000, the New York Times wrote an article about the Bohemians living in Williamsburg. They didn't use the word hipster, but we knew what they were talking about. White people who were in bands moving to crappy neighborhoods. By 2003, the Hipster Handbook was published in Williamsburg, presumably on a handmade, movable type printing press with a font designed by the author's ex-girlfriend he's still super tight with. There, hipsterdom was clearly defined. It was a combination of all of the countercultures that had gone before it. You had the rejection of mainstream white culture from the 40s hipsters. You had the anti-capitalist progressive politics of the 60s hippies, the anti-authoritarian stream of punk, the passion for graffiti of hip-hop, and the cultural distance and irony of 90s grunge. But the defining elements of hipsterdom were a comfort with communications technology that was thoroughly 21st century, and a passion for nostalgia that inspired them to select a name for themselves that was itself an anachronism. And stupid cowboy shirts. They love stupid cowboy shirts.
Cowboy shirts are so out. Conquistador shirts are it. They're conquistadorable.
Hurry up and subscribe while the Factuary still has some indie cred.
I guess it's ironic if I tell you to uniformly do something, so like, make sure you subscribe.